Hi everybody, I'm Pastor Josh at Olathe Bible Fellowship. The sermon for today is on discernment. So if you're somebody who doesn't know what choices to make, what right from wrong is, up from down, especially in this world where everything is just changing so rapidly in terms of definition, this sermon will be for you. It is the first sermon in our discernment series this year, so make sure that you check it out. So as Beth alluded to, this is our first sermon of the year, and it sets the tone. We are in the middle of the second year of a five-year series on vigilance. So if you go down this list, you see sacrifice, discernment, solidarity, agency, devotion. These are the 5 years that we'll be preaching on these subjects. Last year was sacrifice. This year is discernment. And the question is, what does it mean to be discerning as a Christian? Specifically, what does it mean to be discerning as a Christian who is vigilant, right? So the idea is vigilance. Vigilance specifically pertaining to the concept of a watchman who stands on the wall and is looking to protect what's inside. So every sermon following this sermon this year is going to be somehow connected to discernment, and we are going to be speaking about a lot of things in regard to discerning what it means to be a follower of Christ. Now, typically, my sermons have been very, very long. And I've done my best to limit the amount of time spent in my sermon so that you guys can have time to discuss and so that it's a little more bite-sized for you. So know that if something wasn't fully explained, with all of my heart of hearts, I really wanted to. I probably cut out half of my sermon after writing it. And know that if it's too long, well, sorry guys, I tried. let's get started. When we talk about the concept of discernment, like I said, we're talking about the concept of the watcher on the wall. So the watcher on the wall is guarding his home by peering out night or day, right? He's there to protect his home. Hell or high water, he's there to protect it, looking into the distance. And the safety of his kingdom is dependent upon his clear vision. It's dependent upon understanding what he sees. We've got to pay attention to that. It's his clear vision and understanding what he sees, because should an enemy get close to the wall, it might be able to breach the wall. It might be able to destroy a portion of it that lets other enemies in. Of course, on the other side, should there be a friendly, should there be somebody who is in need of help, somebody who is friendly, somebody who is sick, he has to be the one who tells the people to open the gate, right? He's got to open the gate quickly, because he can't compromise the security of the wall for whatever is following, and his position is of utmost importance. And the watcher's position is a vigilant position, as we've talked about. It calls for him to quickly and accurately assess danger and prosperity, both of the two, and understand what to do with information. Now, like I said, we've spent the last year talking about what type of toll this takes on the watcher. In order to do this properly, it has to be a constant sacrifice on his part. And we spent a lot of time dealing with sacrifice, and quite frankly, spent a lot of year sacrificing. Likewise, to be vigilant, the watcher will have to be discerning. But discernment in the Bible isn't merely the act of choosing, as you might suspect it is. It also comes with a sense of morality. So the year will be spent unpacking the necessity and morality of being a discerning watchman on the wall. And to do this, we have to understand what's behind the concept of discernment. So what is discernment? Well, the word discern means to distinguish, to separate out by diligent search, to examine. The word anakrino in the Greek, that's what it is in the Greek, is used in the New Testament about 16 times. It's also used in the Old Testament, but for our purposes, it's used in the New Testament about 16 times. And each time it denotes an active process, an active process where one is comparing and where one is contrasting what they see. So the question that arises for us, the discerning question, would be, what is the standard for comparison, and what information are we looking for? And to understand these questions, we have to understand why discernment requires a larger discussion in the first place. Why are we even talking about discernment? Well, here's the reason why. Humans are unique creatures. They are, in their propensity for discernment, unique creatures specifically. We're catalogers of information by design. That's how God created us. For creatures of our kind to understand discernment, we have to go back to the Garden of Eden. We have to return to Eden. Here we can begin to see in the Eden narrative clear evidence that from the beginning of our existence, we were having to deal with discernment. The truth is that we've never treated information as neutral. Human beings have never treated information as neutral, but instead viewed it as something to be parsed out to us. In the garden, where we began to receive inputs about what to do with our existence from God Himself, there were two types of inputs. Both types of inputs spoke about who God is, but they're completely different from each other. So the first input we call general observation. The technical theological term for that is general revelation, right? So we have general revelation, or observation if it helps you. It's an observation obtained by the senses that God gave us. Everything that we see speaks about who God is. Everything we smell, believe it or not, everything we taste, it speaks about who God is. So that's the first thing that is spoken into us in the Garden of Eden. And the second is one that can only be revealed by God directly. Theologians call this special revelation. So when we first meet Adam, his prime responsibility in the Garden of Eden is to observe, explore, catalog, and take awe in God's creation. His responsibility is to use the general revelation of God by observation of his creation. And that makes Adam really interesting because he's essentially a unique curator. What makes him unique is that he himself is a fascinating piece of artwork that tells other pieces of artwork and anybody who's looking, like angels, for instance, about the artwork that's in the museum. Imagine you go into a museum and then you see a piece of art that is walking, talking, understands the whole layout of the museum, and tells people where to go to look at other art. That's Adam. But he himself is a piece of art. So all of this said, though observation, the general observation or the general revelation given to us starting in Eden, though observation was a powerful and meaningful way to understand everything, it was never supposed to be the primary form of gaining knowledge. This can be easily demonstrated by looking at the very first mystery in the Bible. So what you might ask is the very first mystery in the Bible. Well, there was a mystery that was located conveniently in the center of the garden. The mysterious tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and of course its fruit. And we should note that the tree was centered in the garden. So it was in the very center of the garden. And this is important for making it a mystery. This means that for Adam, who, like I said, was a being who cataloged information, the location of the tree would be very important to him. As a cataloger of information, having something centralized would be very important to him. It was a focal point by which other information about the garden could also be understood. It was a landmark to know how to return home, no matter where in the garden he stood. And yet, despite Adam's dependence on this tree to create a compass by which he could define his location relative to other things, there was something special about this tree. There was something mysterious about this tree. It wasn't made to be freely accessed by men. This tree served a very distinct and different function than the other trees, because although it looked like the others, it represented a piece of knowledge that simply could not be understood solely by man's observation of God's general revelation. And that, of course, wasn't a secret to men. It's not like God kept that a secret. In fact, God made that point very clear to Adam. He made it very clear and plain to him, and Adam knew that in very certain terms, under no circumstances, was that tree to be consumed. It wasn't meant for consumption. The tree was essentially off limits, despite how it appeared. And remember, according to general revelation, general observation, the tree appeared delicious, it appeared necessary, and it appeared accessible. Those facts, that it was both accessible and yet strangely not mixed with man's freedom to explore, are exactly why we should view the tree in the middle of the garden as the first mystery. Because man was told not to partake of it, and yet God placed it right in front of him. And from that tree, all the mysteries and miseries that we have in this world have blossomed. And ever since, man has tried to understand this mystery. And ever since, man has failed at understanding this mystery. And it continues to rape and pillage everything that it comes into contact with. And why not? Why shouldn't it? The tree that God gave us is observationally ours, right? Put in the garden, a garden that was given to us. It was in our care. It was useful for our task of cataloging. It was observationally good to eat. The only thing different about it on the surface is that God told us not to eat from it. We obviously didn't get it then. We couldn't get it now without Christ. And though perhaps it's difficult to understand even with Christ, that tree has been the source of all of our difficulties. And honestly, would that it have never existed in the first place, except for one fact. And that one fact is that it was put there to accomplish God's good will for us. That tree was meant to be a beacon. It wasn't meant for food. It was meant to be a beacon. It was meant specifically to be a machine of sorts there in the garden to serve a very specific purpose. And that tells us that even in a perfect place, like Eden, general revelation from our senses and special revelation from God's counsel can sometimes seem at odds with each other. Sometimes, when we look at information, it can be a mystery. What appears good by man's observational prowess is not always good for him. Truthfully, all general revelation is bad for men if not oriented by the special revelation of God. We have to understand that Adam's choice to eat the fruit was more than just a choice between items on a dinner menu. God had given him special revelation about this tree. Don't eat of it, right? It represented a choosing of sources from which to receive his knowledge. Would he get his knowledge from the revelation that he got from God, from his relationship with God, or would he get it from trusting his own observations? Now, in the Eden narrative, it doesn't take very long, of course, before Adam comes face to face with this choice. Obviously, he was given it when he was given instructions, but now it's being thrown in his face. And how he handled that would be the one moment that would define all other moments for us humans. And we all know how that turned out, right? Adam chose to eat the fruit. Man fell. End of story. Despite the revelation from God about the functions of this tree in the Garden of Eden, that it was to be seen, but not to be eaten, for the safety of mankind, Adam decided to ignore the narrative of God and replace it with his own understanding, based specifically on his general understanding of general revelation. Obviously, there were probably other factors. It was Eve who offered him the fruit. So he was afraid of being lonely, probably. You know, it looks good to eat. Maybe he was hungry. But all of that said, he downgraded God's relationship with him in that process. He downgraded God's relationship with him and lifted up his own ideas, his own inputs. No matter how you parse it, put in more succinct terminology for today, Adam switched his inputs, right? He rewired himself because free will is problematic. Adam became a cord cutter, disconnected from his God, for the promise, of course, of becoming his own God. He saw what was good in his own eyes. He decided to live by that knowledge instead of living in the faith and hope of the knowledge that came from his daily walks with God and the things revealed there. So God says, don't eat the fruit. And Adam says, I'm going to do as I want to. Yeah, maybe those words weren't used, but that's the idea, right? And so here we are. We fast forward however many years to now, and what do we have? We have an endless history of that same choice couched in different circumstances and different proper nouns. Every time, though, the same question is being put forth. Now, Adam, he's going to state it from his perspective, right? He's going to state the question something like this. Is what is before me, this choice, good to my eyes? Is it good to my flesh? Is it good to my life? But God would have him state it like this. By what standard do I view this thing that is clearly desirable? And of course, God knows that it's desirable. Like, nobody is saying that the tree wasn't desirable. And when we come faced with choices, nobody's saying that those choices aren't desirable. God knows that it's a thing that we would want. And the reason why he knows that is because he put it there because it's a thing that we would want. But not in the context that we want it. He wants it in the context that he wants it. It's not the tree that's bad, even though mythology has sort of made it into that. Pandora's box, which holds all the demons in the world. It's not the tree that's bad. The tree gets a bad rap. It's man's perspective on the tree. To understand the Eden narrative, we have to ask the right questions about it. We have to ask all the facts that are surrounding it. When we take up the role of an investigator, like a forensic investigator for truth, we have to understand the right questions. And understanding those questions are what are of utmost importance. We need to understand that a simple subject, like what meal do I eat, is capable of a life and death outcome. And I know that that sounds extreme, but think about it. Obesity is one of the number one reasons why Americans are dying and have all sorts of complications, because they don't think about their food. In scripture, food is often linked to life and death in substantial ways. And to illustrate this, God often links food to life and death. Like, for instance, today, after I get done preaching, we are going to be taking the communion. And the communion is what? Food. And what does the communion represent? Life and death. Right? So it is linked in so many ways. And maybe we should be paying a lot more attention to the food that we consume. That, of course, is another lesson for another time, possibly taught by my wife, who's a nutritionist. But the setting has been laid for our discussion, okay? The setting has been laid for our discussion, and yet there's one more piece of information that we're just kind of leaving out here, which is what do we do about the serpent in the Garden of Eden? Because that's another player, right? So the serpent plays a unique role in the Eden narrative. It's a bringer of dissent, to be sure, but what we need to understand is the nature of that dissent. Two things must be understood about the serpent. First of all, that the serpent has an agenda, and second of all, that the serpent lies. And when I say that the serpent has an agenda, I'm not going to take too much time, believe it or not, discussing the great detail in which we can link up the history of God with the rebellion of the serpent, because we can do a lot of that. But what I will say about it is to summarize it as a narrative conflict. God wants to define history as he wants to define it, but the serpent wishes to define history as he wants to define it, and that's the agenda of the serpent, to usurp God's authority on the definition of history. Now, forget about what the serpent was trying to accomplish for a second, and consider what the serpent was actually suggesting when he encountered Eve. So we can find that in Genesis 3, and it goes like this, starting at verse 1. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. And one day he asked the woman, "Did God really say that you must not eat from the fruit of any of the trees in the garden?" "Of course, we may eat from the trees in the garden," the woman replied. "It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. God said you must not eat or even touch it. If you do, you will die." Now, of course, if you're paying attention, you'll know that there's already some lies that have happened in here and some things that are not true that the serpent has been able to get Eve to sort of cop to. But despite that, the serpent says, "You won't die!" Exclamation point. "God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you'll be like God, knowing both good and evil." Well, the woman was convinced. The woman was convinced. She saw, observed, that the tree was beautiful, and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom that it would give her. And so she took some of the fruit and ate it, and then she gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness, and so they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. See, there's a statement being made here about man, and subsequently about God, by the serpent and his questions. And he starts off by saying, "Did God really say?" Did God really say? The very first question in the Bible. It has a subtext, right? "Did God really say" is not actually a question on the part of the serpent, because he has an agenda. It is a statement. It is a statement with a subtext. And the subtext is, maybe God is a liar. That is the subtext. And the serpent goes on to confirm that that is his narrative point by outright rejecting the warning that God gives to Eve, which she misquoted, by the way. God doesn't say you can't touch the tree. In any case, but he goes outright and rejects it with a giant exclamation point. "No, that's not what God said. You won't die. God knows that you'll be like him." Okay, so now not only has he called God a liar, but let's add another subtext. God is afraid of you. That's the next thing the serpent says. God is afraid of you. And just for giggles, let's go ahead and throw in there a hidden statement that man is capable of being God. Because what does the serpent say? "Then you will be like God. Eat the fruit, you will know right from wrong, and then you will be like God." If not ontologically, then at least functionally. I'm sure he didn't add that point, but. So here we see statements about the anthropology and the theology that was taking place in the statement of the serpent. Anthropology being the study of men, and theology being the study of God, right? Take note, because that is the playing field upon which all discernment lives, in anthropology and theology. What do we understand about God, and what do we understand about man? Knowing that these statements are paired and being posed in every piece of information that we are exposed to is going to be rudimentary in understanding the choices that are before you. We are, by our own agency, agents of our own demise. In Eden, we became active participants now, because we joined with the serpent. We understood his lie to be delicious. And so we joined with the serpents, and now we become active participants in Satan's rebellion. And before we can even begin to seriously discuss discernment, we have to start here. We have to give a context to discernment, which is specifically that we are at war with God. The scripture calls it enmity. We are at war with God to begin with. Since Eden, we have been on the wrong side of it, and we're causing our own destruction in juxtaposition, of course, to God's plan for benefit and his glory. That's always been the plan of Satan, our destruction at the cost of God's glory. So Satan wants us listening to ourselves, and God wants us listening to him, and that's the crux of discernment. That's where discernment lives. To whom do we listen? Do we listen to Satan and what his side of the war says, or do we listen to God? Again, it wasn't just a meal choice. We weren't being offered just food. We were being offered an idea. It was not neutral, because the choice was actually to be within the bounds of God's providence or to try to go outside of them. And the choice was offered by a being who wanted slash wants to destroy God. What we are choosing in our every decision is not menu items. It's sides in a very old conflict. So therefore, in this wartime context, the Bible is very clear that our perceptions are not neutral functions. It matters what we choose, whenever we choose it, why we choose it. How we choose to define things is not merely a life and death utilitarian truth, but it's also a moral function. It is a moral function that states whether we've given up who we are in the light of who God made us to be. And in his few short verses in the Eden narrative, we see that the serpent advocates that man should lean into the mystery of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And when I say lean into it, what I mean is that the serpent wishes for man to uncover the mystery of the tree rather than allow it to function as God had intended it. Remember, I told you the tree is a machine. And the machine keeps the lights on. What Satan wants us to do is take apart the machine so that it doesn't keep the lights on. Why do we think it is that he wants us to do that? He could have just offered the choice to Adam and Eve to join sides with him. So why does he want us to do that? The serpent offers that Eve, and subsequently Adam, seek a different truth than what they had been told. And it's a simple revision for him to do this. Remember that God wants the tree to serve that function of a machine, acting as a beacon by which man can orient himself and demonstrate his dependence on God. But the serpent wanted man to see the tree as primarily for his consumption. So I guess what it would look like is that the serpent actually just wanted the tree to be gone. He wanted the tree to be destroyed as a machine. So if we read between the lines, if man consumes the fruit of the tree, he's not supposed to, man consumes the fruit of the tree, then the tree is no longer the beacon that it was meant to be. That's pretty significant. The tree is no longer the beacon that it was supposed to be. Therefore, man loses his ability to orient himself in God's creation. And now that he can't orient himself in God's creation, he suffers the penalty that God had placed upon Adam when he made that boundary. Yet, death, but not just death alone, but also a disconnection from God. And that disconnection brings shame and guilt and numerous other consequences. Not the least of which is, of course, that man can no longer understand right from wrong. And because the tree no longer functions as it used to, man has no way of getting back to that understanding. You see, literally, what Satan wanted to do was make it so that man had no hope of orienting himself in God's creation. And it's actually a really great war tactic, if you think about it, right? Don't destroy the enemy, destroy the enemy's ability to perceive, to know himself in reference to something. If you can destroy his ability to know himself in reference to something, then you can take away a soldier's understanding of himself. You can take away his allegiance. You can take away his mission, what he fights for, and how to use his weapons. And then if you drop him in the middle of a battle, what do you expect will happen to him? Well, there's two things that could happen to him. Number one, he could pick the wrong fight and end up dead. Or number two, he could find the wrong person who could then conscript him to his side. Now, so many people, they ask this question, if God is God and Satan is Satan, and Satan wants to win this war with God, but God is this infinite creature, this being who's beyond things, how could he possibly win the war? Satan can't take out God. That would make him absolutely stupid. Have we considered that perhaps the goal isn't to take out God, but it's to ruin God's glory? Why take out God, an infinite being that you can't take out, when you can make him suffer infinitely? Seems to me like Satan may have done a good job making that happen. It's a pretty good war tactic. Fortunately, God came down and reacclimated Adam and Eve almost instantly. He gave them a promise of a savior. He drew clear lines for them. Again, he covered their shame of their nakedness, which was, by the way, not a new fact. It's not like they didn't just become naked. They were already naked. They just had a new perception of those facts. He covered their nakedness by shedding an animal's blood. And then he kicked them out of the garden into a world that wasn't pleased with them. That would have been a very traumatic event. A single mistake with infinite consequences that had left their world torn up and upside down. And what could be done about this? You know why the rainbow is so significant? Because it hadn't rained before. If you go back and you look at scripture, the earth was watered by fountains that, you know, came out of the ground. And when the flood came, what God made happen was he made those fountains release all of their water up into the air. And that is how the flood came to be. And now the earth is watered by the evaporation cycle, essentially, of that water coming up and down. What do you think happened when it rained for the first time after the flood? I'm guessing they were pretty freaked out. And the sun's shining, and then there's this thing that they've never seen, a prism in the sky, and God says, you see that? That means I will never destroy the earth the same way, so don't be afraid. See, the rainbow has much more of a significance than our culture gives it. I'm guessing that after this single traumatic event where they were kicked out of the garden, man was very, very skeptical about every choice that he could possibly make from then on. I'm guessing he was very scared. Anxious. Unlike before, every choice wasn't by default a good one. Remember, in Eden, everything was set up for their success. Every choice was a good choice. But now every choice was the possibility of destroying everything that you ever knew. Even the choice of what food to eat. And so man becomes obsessed with this idea, how can I not screw things up? And he lives in anxiety. And I imagine that the discussions between Adam and Eve at that point became very difficult. It's already difficult when you're with your spouse talking about what food you want to get that night for takeout. For those of you who don't know, you know, what thing you're going to watch, whatever. Imagine The last choice that Adam made and the last choice that Eve made got them kicked out of the Garden of Eden. Probably pretty awkward. And that's why man has a deep-seated anxiety. Respectfully, not to diminish the sincerity of that blunder, it absolutely was, God had our stupidity factored in when he made us. That wasn't the end for us. He had it factored in. He had a backup plan, if you will, which he immediately revealed to Eve in the Garden of Eden, right? See, they were anxious and afraid, and rightfully so, because they had incurred God's wrath and the world was uncertain. Let's take a second and talk about fear and their uncertainty, okay? God had this backup plan, but in order to talk about that backup plan, we really have to talk about fear, which they had become, you know, afraid. So we're going to digress and talk about fear for a second. It's a major role in discernment. You see, in this day and age, we view fear as something to be avoided, to the point that we almost feel like FDR was a prophet. You guys know who I'm talking about when I say FDR, right? For those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, I'm referring to Franklin Delano Roosevelt, in my opinion, one of the greatest presidents ever. But he said something very important. We have nothing to fear but fear itself. Okay? We act like that's in scripture. It's not, by the way. But what nobody ever quotes is the subtext of that statement, which is that we have nothing to fear but fear itself because we are morally correct. See, that's what FDR thought. We were morally correct, and so therefore we don't have anything to fear when we're being moral. So I want to discuss that for a moment because fear often gets misunderstood. See, fear is only negative in a specific context. Now, a sloppy exegesis might quote 1 John where it says that perfect love expels fear. Okay? Perfect love drives out fear. But if you read further, the context is actually explained in that very passage that fear that is cast out is actually a fear of judgment. That's what's being expelled. A fear of judgment. It doesn't mean if you love that you can't fear consequences for bad decisions. The fear that love casts out is the irrational fear based upon not having a secure relationship with Christ's sacrifice for our sins. But in general, fear is actually spoken of generally as a useful thing. It's positive in a lot of places. Fear is proper in a specific context. And as we talk about the watcher on the wall, and we talk about discernment, we have to note that fear is a powerful motivator toward keeping us vigilant and knowing which direction we're supposed to face in life. Fear has its place. Adam and Eve became fearful. What place, you might ask, does fear have? Proverbs 1 states that the fear of the Lord is the foundation of true knowledge. Proverbs 9 calls it the beginning of wisdom, something that along with discipline, fools despise. So in point of fact, we are commanded to fear God. And subsequently, we're faced with a choice as to whether we will fear God or not. And we are given consequences for what to do with that choice. It has to be a big choice if the consequences of fearing God in the positive are that wisdom and knowledge are gained. So that seems like a worthy tangent for us to break off onto as we're discussing vigilance. So what does the choice to fear God actually entail? Well, the word fear is the same word that can mean terror. It can mean reverence. It can mean respect. And without context, it can be difficult to grasp why we would want to fear the Lord. And many push back on the concept of fearing God just because the English word fear is present within it, but they're missing an important part of discernment. And that specific part of discernment is that wartime narrative that we were talking about. See, it's appropriate as war criminals, which is what we start out as, to fear God. It's entirely appropriate to fear God. We should fear his vengeance against us. For having been conscripted to the side of his dissenters, we should fear his power and what he's capable of and how incapable we are in comparison. We should have awe and reverence in us the way that a nuclear blast should be feared. The list of reasons to fear God is pretty much endless for an infinite God to a finite creature. That type of fear is entirely appropriate for the enemy of God. In other words, if you're God's enemy, you have a reason to be afraid of him. But there's still something more there. See, the idea of the fear of God is a multifaceted concept. It's for our benefit, even when we're not God's enemies. No matter what, the thing to hold on to really has nothing to do with the choice to fear God, but instead why we should fear God. To the criminal, it's because you are his enemy. I will either fear God because I remember him and my relationship with him, or I will fear God because I choose to try to forget about him. And those who choose to forget him should feel terror. That's what makes them enemies with God. They choose to forget him, and so they should feel terror. But a believer's choice should be to fear God because they remember him. See, fearing God is remembering God. Remembering him is acknowledging him in his many facets. And the man who doesn't remember God is the man who should fear God. And the one who does fear him is the one who always remembers him. The one who does fear God is the one who knows him. And because he chooses to know him, because he chooses to remember him, his fear doesn't grow into phobia. It doesn't grow into folly, as Proverbs would state. Instead, it grows into respect. The one who chooses to try to forget God ends up fearing him in the way of terror. He doesn't know God in any sort of practical way in the way that he lives his life. And he evolves naturally in his mind into a boogeyman that's out to punish him. Paul says this in Romans chapter 1. He says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is evident within them. For God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse. For even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give him thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened, and professing to be wise, they became utter fools." Fear for the criminal looks different than fear for the just. But it's still fear. In the context of Eden, they chose to forget God, and they feared the consequences of living against their own understanding more than the consequences of living outside of his. So let's return from our tangent of fear and apply it. Adam and Eve became afraid of the consequences of their choices, and they became afraid of God, and they became afraid of each other, and they were even afraid of their own nakedness. But fear can be used by God. Fear can be used by God to create knowledge. So to be clear, why they feared may have been bad, but they weren't properly fearing God to begin with, were they? If they were, then they wouldn't have eaten the fruit. But now they were properly fearing God. Now they understood the consequences of their behavior. And all it takes is that moment to return them to the state of remembrance for true knowledge and wisdom to be gained. because true knowledge and wisdom is predicated upon that return to living in remembrance of who God is and seeing things by his view. Why do we think that God gives things to remember? Why do we think he gives us those things? Why do we think we're told in communion to remember him? You see, to truly know anything, we have to remember God. What does someone who remembers God do when they are faced with a choice? In fear and reverence for God, they will ask a simple question. How does God see it? That's the question. When a choice comes to them, how does God see it? See what? You may ask, and isn't that, of course, too big a question? I mean, we could be talking about so many things. How does God see it? How can I know what God thinks of everything? It's too much for my little finite brain to process. Well, first of all, stop it. That's an excuse. Adam was a cataloging being. He was set up to know right from wrong, not by his own understanding, but by what? God's counsel. He was set up to know right from wrong by God's counsel, not by his own understanding. And we have that counsel in human form before us. As the Bible states in John 1, right? And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. And John testified about him and cried out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, he who comes after me has a higher rank than I, for he existed before me. For his fullness we have all received, grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth were realized through Christ Jesus. No one has seen God at any time, the only begotten who is in the bosom of the Father. He has explained him." So Jesus is the Word become flesh. We have everything we need because it's by God's counsel, his word, that we understand things, not by our own observational truth. And when you say, "I can't possibly understand right from wrong because that's too much to process," you don't understand how to process right and wrong. If you have Jesus, you have everything you need. When you say this sort of thing, you limit your ability to know what is right. And when you limit your ability to know what is right based upon God's counsel, but instead put the weight of that upon yourself to discern right from wrong, you are doing what? You are eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Rather than accepting the counsel of God, you're believing that if you can't touch it, if you can't taste it, you can't exhaust its form, you can't dominate it into your body by your own human effort, then you somehow don't know the truth. You're not demonstrating your fear of God, but you are instead demonstrating fear of yourself. But those who remember God, those people who remember God, know that you can know the truth truly. It has to be revealed to you in Christ. And it continues to be revealed through the lens of his word, by the understanding of the Spirit and the exampling of his body on the earth and in the church. And if you can't know the truth, or you don't know the truth, it's because you're choosing to carry the burden by your own observation and not revelation, not trusting in God. Remembering him to want to reveal it to you as he meant it to be in Eden. So my advice to you is put the fruit down and pick up the word. That's the crux of true discernment. Every choice before you is a question of whether you hold the forbidden fruit or you hold the counsel of God's word in your hand. And that, like I said before, is always where the battle lies for humans. Do we do as we will, or do we do as God wills? And though the push to define ourselves down to something so seminal as our very gender is touted as the pinnacle of human virtue in this day and age, what many have not understood in their woke, self-aggrandizing ways is that their motto of "do what you will" is in fact completely the exact message of Satan in the Garden of Eden. That worldview that we should parse all decisions by what seems good in our own eyes is a damnable offense. It puts us in league with God's enemy. It's incompatible with the work of Christ's incarnation and with the way in which he understood his very life. And it was not his will that should be done, but that even when he knew it would cost him his life, it was his Father's will that should be done. And yet we sit in a world of professing Christians who knowingly speak the motto of the devil. We sit in a world of Christians who proudly fund its proliferation to their children, who are mindlessly entertained by the idea of people doing what they will, who try to marry that with God's counsel, who tear apart churches by profane outworkings, who weigh every decision by inherent cynicism toward God. But bitter springs don't yield fresh waters. So let me be clear. There is no place in the church for a standard of self. It is not I who defines my sexuality. It is God. It is not I who defines my gender. It is God. It is not I who defines my allegiance. It is God. Those who continue to place the weight on their own shoulders to define their own reality, who want the right to define themselves in every aspect from physiology to infatuation by what seems good to them in their own eyes, who place the fact that they are first image bearers of a creator beneath and behind the things of creation, gender, race, sex, wealth, power, all appetites of the flesh and the eyes and the pride of life, and who encourage each other to do the same, they all face the wrath of God and do suffer within themselves the penalties that they rightfully deserve. A Christian is one who claims to remember God, to fear him, and they're not swayed by what looks good to their eyes. And they don't say, do what you will, when God's counsel knocks at the door of their heart. They don't direct others to a blog. They don't direct others to a post, a YouTube video, a Facebook group, an Instagram, a Snapchat, an institution, or a scholar. They aren't moved by influencers, teachers, coworkers, trusted friends, family members, nature, magic, an angel. Not when the very word of God is revealed and available to them in the scriptures. The term believer implies a subject. Christians, they believe in Christ. Not these other things, not idols, not representations of our creaturely hopes and fears, because if you do this, if you measure the world without the fear of God as your foundation, why would you even call yourself a Christian? Worse yet, do you really believe that Christ will call you one when he judges? I don't. What I do believe is that God's counsel says that if you confess your sin in your heart, if you repent of your pride, God will be faithful and just to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. And then you can begin to see the world in its proper context. A masterpiece that's been tarnished by its own efforts to take the brush of the artist out of his hands. And when we restore the brush to his hands, then his world is easily understood. And we can now see the truths of the world in their proper context. We can see what every piece of information means, and more importantly, we can navigate this life with boldness and with confidence. And as we walk the walls, as the watcher does, we can understand whether it is friend or foe that rides upon our city on the hill. By placing all information in the context of Eden, we come back to two questions for us, which is, what does it say about God? And what's it saying about man? When we talk about information, we have to understand that information is not without agenda. It's not neutral, and therefore discernment cannot likewise be a neutral process. Discernment is the act of taking every piece of information and answering those two questions. And how we answer them is an integral part of the foundation upon which we make every moment of our lives. And the question didn't stop in Eden. It is asked of you every day, in every moment, in every choice. So complicated as that sounds, it actually means that proper and biblical discernment with all of its variables can actually be achieved with a very simple metric in life. When we live by our own desires, when we face every choice driven by the arbitrary standards of our finite lusts and fears and short-sighted vision, when we forget God, then the options are overwhelming and the outcomes dire. But when we take the weight off of ourselves to define the world, and we simply give that standard back to God, it means that we can move freely, freely within his structure. And here's the trick. Whatever choice we make in life, we have to ask ourselves what that choice says about God and what it says about man. Then we check it against what it's been revealed in the scripture, and if it lines up, then we move boldly forward. And if it doesn't, then we reject its truth. That is the process of biblical discernment in a nutshell. Tell the truth about man, tell the truth about God. Tell the truth about man, tell the truth about God. Live in hope of God's faithfulness that we will be provided for. We don't need 613 separate laws to understand that truth. That's a reference to Judaism, in case you guys don't know. You don't need to weigh every possibility, which of course is an infinite task for a finite creature. In point of fact, you don't need to ask many questions at all, if any. You just got to give a response to the question being asked of you. What is being said about God and what is being said about man? You don't need to know everything exhaustively. You just need to know the truth. The simple rule, do not eat from the tree in the middle of the garden. Leave it as it was intended. Let's briefly consider the interaction between Jesus and Satan. Matthew 4 talks about it. Jesus is about to enter his ministry. He's about to proclaim himself to be the Messiah, the enemy of God's enemies, and the salvation of his people. And the Bible says that the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness to prepare for his ministry. He was brought there to face temptation by the Holy Spirit, brought into the wilderness to face temptation. And it should be noted that this is a significant time for Jesus. For 40 days, he fasted and spent time in prayer. And beyond this, it is often overlooked that the Jewish desert, the wilderness, had a very specific, non-spiritually neutral context. Okay? Jesus, he wasn't on some sort of long camping trip. You know, where he was deciding to not eat. Like Colin just went on a camping trip with Isaiah and they decided to not eat for 3 days to see if they could survive. That wasn't what Jesus was doing. It wasn't a fun trip for him. Jesus was not trying to conserve resources. You see, in Judaism, the wilderness is representative of being outside of God's graces. That's why the Levite priests, for instance, when they were performing sacrifices, they would put the sins of the people onto the goat and send it out into the wilderness That's where we get the term scapegoat from. So they would make this goat the scapegoat for our sins. They would send it out into the wilderness. In spiritual geography, he was cast out of God's graces by the Holy Spirit. And so in that context, he was fasting and he was praying. He was waiting to come back to a city, preparing to be the ceremonial animal upon which the sins of the world would be placed. It was foreshadowing. And it required focus on his part. In other words, God was preparing him. This is about what is going to happen to you. That's what the Holy Spirit is saying. This is going to happen to you. And so Jesus was sent out there, and he's not eating because he was taken there by the Holy Spirit, and he's praying. When Satan found Jesus in the wilderness, Satan showed his connection to the serpent, right? Because he tests Jesus. He tests Jesus with a similar guile. But Jesus, of course, understood the subtext of what Satan was saying to him. Just as the serpent had done to Adam that undercut God's provision. In this case, the provision was that he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness with no provisions. Which, by the way, sometimes that is God's provision. Sometimes God's provision is that you have less than nothing. But it's what's good for you. Satan pointed out to Jesus that, Jesus, you know, you're hungry. God's not really providing for you. Couldn't you just turn this rock into bread? Couldn't you provide for your own needs? Couldn't you forget this imposed hunger upon you and, you know, eat of the fruit? Jesus' response is something we should consider. Matthew 4 says, "During that time the devil came and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become loaves of bread.' But Jesus told him, 'No!' Exclamation point. The scriptures say, 'People do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Satan suggests that Jesus provide for himself in his hunger and in his fatigue. And he opens up the door to the variable of Jesus' own providence against God's leading. But of course, Jesus understood that making bread, as Satan was suggesting, wasn't just making bread. Not like Jesus had a problem with making bread. He did it a couple times in Scripture, right? Loaves and fishes, where he tears the bread off and it just keeps happening. It wasn't just making bread in this moment. It was a statement. Statement about man. That man has the power to operate against God's will, and that God doesn't provide. Jesus' answer is clear. On the issue of God, God provides his will and counsel. And since it was God who brought him to this place, the desert, the wilderness, with its hunger and its despair, then it is good for him to be there. And it's right for him to be hungry. And on the issue of men, Jesus affirms to Satan that man is a creature who may need bread, but not more than the words of God. And it was the word of God that brought him to the desert. It was God's will. It was God's command. It was by that the Holy Spirit led him to the desert. And what's more, it is this very word of God which Jesus would use to refute the devil. He calls out of Scripture what was obviously going through his mind during this time, which was the story of the Jews who had been put into the wilderness because they refused to submit to God. Recounted by Moses to prepare them for life in the salvation of the promised land. And this is what Deuteronomy 8 says. "Be careful to obey all the commands that I am giving you today," speaking to the children of Israel who were in the desert, forced to walk there, to be ready to go to the promised land. Be careful to obey all the commands I am giving you today, and then you will live and multiply, and then you will enter and occupy the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness for these 40 years? 40 years? 40 days. Humbling you and testing you to prove your character and to find out whether or not you would obey his commands? Yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry. And then he fed you with manna, a food previously unknown to you and your ancestors. He did it to teach you that, ready for it? People do not live by bread alone, but rather we live by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. For all these 40 years, your clothes didn't wear out, your feet didn't blister or swell. Think about it. Just as a parent disciplines a child, the Lord your God disciplines you for your own good. You think it's by coincidence that Jesus says what he says? He had the scripture on his mind. When he was called out into the wilderness, he was living by the very word of God that he had studied and knew. And it was the hope within the word of God that fed him during that time. And when Satan comes after Jesus, he doesn't argue the variables. Jesus doesn't argue the variables. He doesn't vision board a response. He doesn't workflow a solution to his hunger. Instead, with scripture on his mind, he knew what was going on. He knew why God had called him to the wilderness, and because of revelation in scripture, he knew what was at stake. And the Father had called his ancestors into the wilderness before as an act of discipline to prepare them for life in the promised land and to teach them the truth that they were to depend on God, God alone. So during this time of heat and fasting and prayer, Jesus was remembering at the forefront of his mind that God provides. Other than to say his emphatic no exclamation point to Satan, Jesus didn't speak even his own words. But instead, he speaks plainly about the choice given to him by using scripture. For Jesus, the way to handle the choice was clear. The only worthwhile response to an accusation in the question, the same temptation and accusation made about God by the early Jews, it was to speak the truth revealed in scripture about man and God, that God has provided, that God will provide. Man must live by God's word and not by his hunger. And two more times, Satan tries to trick Jesus with options to speak lies about God and man. And as we stand at watch upon our wall, he will come to you in the same way as well. Each time, Jesus always responds the same. He reveals the truth by speaking God's word. That should be an indication to us about the veracity of the universal application of scripture against a myriad of options. Just because there isn't a scripture that says, now when the devil says you should feed yourself by your own hand, do not do it. Just because we can't find that verse in scripture doesn't mean that the Bible doesn't speak to that choice. Or any of the other choices out there, like don't have an abortion. Sorry, but if you say, well, Jesus didn't say it, that's just lazy. See, God wants thinking Christians. He wants his followers not to be cosmic yes men. He wants us to understand that he speaks on everything. So a bit ago, we discussed the error of saying that we can't discern because we don't have enough information. But what I'm saying here is that not only that is an excuse, but it also doesn't understand what information we actually have, which is that we pretty much have everything that we need. Not only should we open our eyes to the idea that we can know because of our relationship with Christ, but we should accept that we can also live victoriously and even stand against Satan because of what we do know. which is the Word of God itself. So you may not know what God would say to a specific circumstance if you're forced to deal with it. But you can know what God's general principles are and apply it to that circumstance just by knowing God's word. Of course, if you're willing to learn God's word. The more you delve into committing his counsel to your heart and the more you practice applying it, the less you need to know the specifics of God's thoughts because you will know the heart that produced them. I mentioned before that my wife is a nutritionist. If I want to eat a Twinkie, my daughter says, "What's a Twinkie?" That's because my wife is a nutritionist. If I want to eat a Twinkie, I can't in good conscience claim that because I've never asked my wife if I should eat a Twinkie, that I don't know that she will not be okay with me eating a Twinkie. That is ridiculous. So what I do is I eat one in secret. And shame and guilt. And then I join up with Weight Watchers. The reason why I say I eat one in secret is because that's what people do. The truth is that people often hide the fact that they know that a choice is against God's general parameters and his heart, and they do it by changing the grammar of that choice to excuse the lack of conviction toward what they already know. Paul calls this phenomenon suppression. Suppression is a very visceral idea. It means holding something underwater, strangling it so that it can't speak. That we suppress the truth. That's the reason why in our society we call abortion abortion instead of murder. It's the reason why in our society we call babies fetuses, which is just Latin for baby. Because doing so cleverly hides the truth. And how clever Adam must have been as he and Eve sat there vigorously sewing their fig leaves together. They really thought they were hiding something from God, huh? Not by a long shot. As believers with the Word of God in our Bibles, we have no excuse for not understanding the base parameters of every choice. The very fact of our salvation, the common truth of our fellowship as believers, is predicated upon the idea that we accept what God says about himself and about us. And you cannot be a Christian without admitting the truth about your relationship with God. There isn't a believer in this room who hasn't said something they know to be true about who God is and who man is in relationship with God. It's impossible. It is the very reason you can call yourself a believer. Therefore, anyone who denies these basic truths by altering language or using euphemisms or claiming ignorance is actually just plain and unabashedly lying. Which makes sense and leads to an interesting point. One might conclude that to not know what to do with a choice, at least on a cosmic level, is to simply not participate in an outcome. After all, we can't be accused of making a bad decision if we abstain from making decisions altogether, right? But biblically, abstinence isn't really the opposite of discernment. Lying is. We can't abstain from making statements about God because everything we do either glorifies him or it shuns him. So to make any choice, even that of not choosing, is in fact to make a statement, even to choose to abstain from making a statement is, in fact, making a statement. And every statement is a statement about who God is and who you are. So as a believer, we have to first tell the truth about that fact, and then every choice we have to let be a statement and do so boldly. We do this by relying on our experience gained by testing the revelation of the scriptures in our lives, and we realize in that every Christian has at least a truth about himself and his God to start with. No one can claim as a Christian to not know enough and still claim to be a Christian. And that means that I'm talking to each of you, young and old. Each of you has everything you need in your very salvation, and it doesn't matter whether you're a preschooler or you're a professor. So as alluded earlier, first you take the choice that has been offered, and you ask these two questions. What does that say about God? What does it say about men? Then you test it by what has been revealed in Scripture at a base level, what you already know, that you are a sinful creature, that you are in need of God, that's a free gift that you accept. You tell the truth. That's all there is to discernment. We're going to spend the next year dealing with what that looks like in practical outcomes so that you can learn how to apply those truths, because even though it's simple, it's not always easy. But I'm going to hit you up real quick here. Let's talk about race. One of today's biggest choices being given to everyone and America specifically is to accept, maybe you guys have heard this, that if you're white, you are racist inherently, because you are by nature privileged beyond a balance of power, or at least your ancestors were. You are supposed to view yourself as inherently racist, regardless of whether you have malintent or not. You are to view yourself, if you're white, as inherently racist, and understand your racism is actually a part of your identity. Now, yeah, that's a simplification, but I believe it's an accurate one, of something we call critical race theory. So, do I accept my inherent racism as a white man? I mean, I guess I'm not white, but all of you white people? Should you accept your inherent racism as a white man? You do know that's a choice, right? It's a choice to do that. And whenever there's a choice, it's a call for you to start to think. And the two things you should be thinking about are, in that choice, what is being said about God and what is being said about man? It'll be tempting to do more because we as humans like to be tangential, but all you have to do is ask the question, what's being said about God and what's being said about man? So first, that choice, it says that a human's value is based upon the power he holds or the color of his skin. Biblically, that's a lie. It's not founded. A human's value doesn't change regardless of the power he holds or the color of his skin. His skin color has, in fact, zero part to play in his worth, as does the power that he holds. So here we have to do away with the idea of privilege being a defining factor in value. God says that kings and paupers alike have the same cosmic privilege, and the only cosmic privilege that matters to him is the fact that humanity in all of its technicolor splendor are image bearers of God. But even if you didn't know that, and all you know is that you're a sinner saved by grace, so again, all you are is a baby Christian, this would also be problematic. And the reason why is that idea of grace. Grace is favor that can't be earned. In other words, we have no worthiness towards God's favor, no matter what we do. God loves us regardless of our worthiness. So your value in terms of your worth is by default the worst value that you could have. Because you can't ever earn anything from God. A biblical view would be to say that, yes, white men are terrible, along with every color of man. That's the biblical view. Because we all need grace for salvation. And when your value is brought to the equation, it doesn't make you look better. In fact, it makes you look worse. Because our righteousness is as filthy rags to God. So without even a complex knowledge of theology, to add one's privilege to our understanding of our value is to add a standard of works into our value that isn't present in a simple gospel understanding of who we are as humans. In fact, the more privileged or racist that we are, the more God wants to restore our value to his self by his grace. Secondly, because it's lying about men and their values, switching out God's grace for man's merit based on his skin tone or the positive or negative works of his ancestors, it also is lying about God. Saying that God allows for any person to be seen as having more value than the other, that we are to be our own saviors and overthrow our oppressors, that relationship is to be governed within the church by a system of retribution rather than reconciliation, that system does not understand God at all. But let's say you don't know theology. That a sinner's prayer alone is all you have. That at a base level, as all Christians have, you've asked God to take away your sins and give him your grace. It still doesn't work. The two ideas are incompatible. Either you're judged by the color of your skin and the works of your ancestors, or you are judged by God's love for you, which denies that skin and works and power even matter. So when faced with the question of your inherent racism and only knowing the basic doctrines necessary to become a Christian, how could even a baby Christian possibly accept the narrative presented to them in that choice to define themselves in terms of critical race theory? No, that would be lying about who God is and who man is to God. As you stand upon the wall and you watch a false prophet ask for entrance into your city, you are to reject them as harbingers of destruction that they are, because they want you to lie about God and about man. And the truth is that even a rudimentary study in Scripture will be able to inform you on numerous issues that will put to test and rest any question of whether you should accept any narrative choice being offered by those who knock at the door of your lives. And almost all of these can be weeded out by our own understanding and acceptance that as Christians, our want as human beings to define things according to what's good in our eyes and our unwillingness to accept God's grace in all facets of our life actually moves us closer to destruction. It doesn't make us better. We don't need to know complex theology. We don't need to know complex theology to know that something is off about these narratives. Just like you don't need to know that when someone serves you feces on a plate and calls it a candy bar, you shouldn't eat it. Hey, while we're at it, let's talk about gender and sex. Without understanding how God deals with gender in Scripture, you can know that your self-definition is the reason why you need God's grace, right? The fact that you want to define yourself is the exact reason why you need God's grace. So then how could you possibly claim that God wants you to define yourself, let alone according to what seems right to you? Isn't it your self-definition? Isn't it the very reason you need to ask for salvation? This is why I say gender is defined by God. Without understanding how God deals with sex in Scripture, you can know that fulfilling your passions according to what seemed right to you is the reason why you need God's grace. How can you then claim that God wants you to take those passions, to indulge them, to even make them a part of your identity according to what seems right to you? Isn't what seems right to you the very reason why you need salvation? Without understanding how God deals with money in Scripture, you can know that you can't earn God's value. That's a free gift. So when you sit there trying to make yourself valuable, isn't that the very reason why you need God's salvation? I could just keep going on and on. Because man finds every possible way to deviate. They go to bed thinking about it. They wake up thinking about it. And they try to conscript everybody into doing it the way that they want to. If I were to try to live counteracting every possible way in which we deviate from how God wants us to be, I would be, you know, exhausted. That's not the way to discern. I don't have to be a mathematician or an accountant to pay for something at the grocery store. I don't have to be a mechanic or an IndyCar driver to go on a road trip with my family. I don't need to be a pastor or a theologian to make a biblically guided decision. Instead, I just need to live by the simple premise of fearing God, remembering Him in all that I do, and asking the right questions as the choices are presented. I just need to see God as He wishes to be seen and see myself as He wishes to see me. All the deep theology that you can learn is, of course, worthwhile. I'm a pastor. I obviously think so. Of course, it's worthwhile. Makes you better at discerning those things. The more you read, the more you discuss, the more you participate from Scripture with believers in the local body, the stronger you will be. But let me be clear, the dumbest, simplest Christian has zero excuse, has zero excuses for not being able to discern right from wrong or from abstaining from making that choice. That person is lying about who God is and about who He is. He's taken upon himself the responsibility to know right and evil by what seems good to him, and he bears upon himself the wrath of God for it. If you truly don't know what to do, because there will be those circumstances where even as a Christian, you're pretty sure, you know, if I don't do this, it's not morally violating. If I do this, you know, you're just not sure what the right answer is. There's something we call the holding principle. It means hold off on it. Ask God to reveal it to you. Study His word. But if you must make a decision, if you must make a decision in that moment, if you're being told to let something in or to go outside, live within God's boundaries. That's my simple statement to you. Live within God's boundaries. When you live within His Eden and you let Him draw the boundaries of what is good and evil, rather than trying to bear that weight of divining that on your own, you may be surprised at how freely you will be able to move. Men tend to box themselves in by placing a wall surrounding them upon which they can be vigilant. That wall is where they have to perch themselves. They have to. They have to perch themselves, constantly circling the realm of what they own in order to keep it safe. And man guards his newfound Eden by locking himself into it, But consider that God intended something different for us. Instead of man needing to draw a wall, he gave man a central point. He gave man a central point upon which his world could be defined. No walls. Freedom to eat and play in the garden. The wall, the very first, was an angel with a flaming sword, according to Genesis. And it only came into being when men decided that they would be their own definition. That they would be their own definition. And they stopped allowing the tree in the center to be their point of reference. But now, in a new kingdom of God, we stand upon the walls of God's kingdom, and they're not borders of county or country, but the bounds of relationship, just as in Eden, navigated by a central point of reference, a tree that stands across time and space, stained in the blood of our Lord and Savior, a new tree of the knowledge of good and evil, conquered by the blood of the Lamb. Your vigilance is no longer the act of encircling your camp, your possessions, but instead of acclimation, of orienting yourself no matter where you are upon the cross. Letting it stand as your true north. Letting it be a compass upon which you can always know where you are, no matter where you stand. And so often, as Christians, we try to draw these walls into our life and even into our own faith. And we draw into the knowledge of good and evil those things and people that we love and that we call, well, we call that wisdom. We've built families, we've built legacies, we've built schools, we've built institutions. We even build churches on the bolstered ruins of the walls of the knowledge of good and evil. And we spend vast resources to protect what we've put inside. And we are so needlessly vigilant in these little camps, within our walls, within our so-called wisdom. We're so discerning. We're actually liars. We don't need the tree of the knowledge of good and evil when we have the cross of Calvary upon which to place our fate and faith. So I say that we should go out from these walls that we have built to be safe, rather than hiding behind them and calling it wisdom. I say that we should live by faith that God knows what's good for us and has provided, and not by the sight of what seems good to our lustful eyes. It's a moment-to-moment choice to be obedient to God. It's found in every decision placed before us. It was the choice of Esau to eat food rather than go hungry, as much as it was in the choice of David to commit adultery with Bathsheba, as much as it was in the choice of Christ to die on the cross. There is no small choice made with the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil at your lips. But thankfully, the solution is simple and provided free. Fear God, speak the truth about him and his creation, and true freedom to navigate this world is given to you. In any choice, in any circumstance, in any place. So, watchmen, this is a year of learning to discern. It's a year where we will challenge you to tear down that which you have built your lives upon. Your predilections, your hiding places. Let God be your first presupposition. Let God be your hiding place. This year, we're going to challenge you to put aside your emotional confirmations and instead take upon the true revelation of God. Follow the advice of Solomon. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Do not depend upon your own understanding. Seek his will in all that you do, and he will show you which path to take. Don't be impressed by your own wisdom. Instead, fear the Lord. and turn away from evil. Follow the words of James. Humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and he will draw close to you. Wash your hands, sinners. Purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided between God and this world. And let there be tears for what you've done. Let there be sorrow and deep grief. Let there be sadness instead of laughter and gloom instead of joy. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up in honor. Watchmen, remember your place. Don't reach for the fruit of your own ideas. Don't say to yourself that truth is defined by the acceptance of our true selves. Stand upon the wall, alert, be ready and willing to make the sacrifice to be discerning. My call is for you to step into this year of learning and living, knowing that you can make the right choices. Enough of saying that you can't. Enough of saying that you don't know. Enough lying. My hope is that you can live as God would have you live, and that you will remember him. Don't fear in the choices ahead of you. Instead, be ready at all times to rise beyond them in every choice, in every struggle. When you wake, when you rest, hold fast. Stay vigilant for the kingdom. Now I have two questions for you. Do you believe that you can navigate life with God's discernment in everything? And is there any choice that you've made that's lying about who God is and who man is?